We invite you to open your Bibles this morning to Romans chapter 1, verse 14 is where we will begin. Our question this morning is, why is the gospel necessary? I wonder how you would answer that. Why is the gospel necessary? There's a whole bunch of good answers. We will focus on at least one of them. But we'll read one verse and or two, or maybe three, and then we'll pray. Romans 1, beginning verse 14. I am a debtor, both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are in Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Father, we ask you for the blessing of your Spirit upon the Word of God to our hearts, that we would hear the Word of the Lord, that we would receive your Word for us today. And for this we pray and give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. I think I've shared with you before that in 2001 there was, or is, I suppose it's still out there somewhere, a clip of actor, comedian Robin Williams, who committed suicide, being interviewed by James Lipton of the Inside the Actor Studio television program. In it, Mr. Lipton ask Robin Williams, if heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates? His response, there's seating at the front. The concert begins at 5. It'll be Mozart, Elvis, and one of your choosing. Or it would be nice to know, if heaven exists, to know that there's laughter. That would be a great thing. Just to hear God go, and he proceeds to have God telling a joke. Well, to multitudes of people, God is a joke. He's not necessary. He's certainly not to be feared, certainly not to be followed. And if there is a heaven, everybody's going. All you have to do to get there is just die. And the hope of heaven is that if there is such a place, it'll be a place just to continue earthly happiness. Streets of gold, mansions, a great reunion of family and friends. I can't wait to see Grandma. And therefore, really, the gospel of Jesus is not necessary. And yet we read something in the Word of God, and we know from the Word of God, and those of you who are sitting here, you know that he is necessary. The gospel is necessary. Verse 16 and 17 says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew and to the Greek. Verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The righteousness of God. The focus here is not stating the biblical truth that God is righteous. He is righteous. But this is talking about the righteousness that is of God. It is declaring that by means of the gospel, God's own righteousness is given to believing sinners. And this is the very heart of the gospel. Sinners can have God's own righteousness. Amen. Now, obviously, only God can give such a righteousness because it's God's righteousness. His own righteousness, a righteousness from God, is revealed, and it starts with faith and it ends with faith. And so the just shall live by faith. This is the verse, verse 17, that the German monk that we know as Martin Luther, the Spirit of God unveiled this to him. And he said, when I saw and understood this, that a righteousness from God is revealed, and it starts with faith and it ends with faith, and it's from God and it's given to sinners, he said, when I saw this and understood this, the doors of paradise swung open and I walked through. Amen. And that was the beginning, for all practical purposes, of what we refer to as the Protestant Reformation, birthed from this one verse. Like so many previous, and like so many today, Luther had given himself very religiously to trying to be righteous enough to get to heaven, and basing his righteousness upon his good deeds. And it was a stunning revelation to him that his hope of heaven was not in anything he could do, but in a righteousness that was given by God. God's own righteousness. Amen. Now, this is obviously good news. So then it is stunning to read the next verse. Verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold or who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. An incredible shift from the good news of righteousness from God to the wrath of God. And let's put an asterisk here to make sure we remember that God's wrath is not like ours. Ours is capricious, unpredictable, usually not well grounded. God's wrath is his settled, consistent, strong opposition to and judgment upon sin, and especially those who commit sin, folks like you and I. We come into this world as sinful beings under the wrath of God. Paul reminded the new Ephesian Christians that you too, before your salvation, you also were children of wrath. So the revelation of the wrath of God and the utter sinfulness of all men is stated here, not only in verse 18, but all the way through chapter 2 and down through verse 20 of chapter 3. That's the main theme of that entire section. That all of the Jews are unrighteous and sinners and under the wrath of God and cannot be saved by anything they have done or can do. And all of the Gentiles are under the wrath of God. These verses, this whole section from verse 18 through verse 20 of chapter 3, unfold for us the necessity of the gospel. And so our focus this morning as to why the gospel is necessary, it is because of the holy and righteous wrath of God. I don't know if there's any stronger reason, if there's any more foundational reason as to why the gospel is necessary. It's totally necessary for the Son of God to come and to be born a babe, to live a sinless life, to die on the cross, and on the cross to take upon himself our guilt and our sin, and to be raised from the dead as demonstration from God the Father, that God the Father is satisfied with the propitiation work of Jesus on the cross, and our sin debt is paid. This is all necessary because of the wrath of God. the holy wrath of God. Nothing can settle it. Nothing can cancel it. But what Jesus did in his sinless life and in his death on the cross for sinners. Amen. The righteous wrath of God makes the gospel necessary. And so the Holy Spirit does not instruct the Apostle Paul to write anything like this. Dear people, please listen to the gospel because you're having so many problems down on earth. Worries, troubles, life getting you down, stresses, pressures. Please come to Jesus. He can help you have a better life. I've just given the invitation that'll be given at many churches all across America. Please come to Jesus. Because if you don't, you'll never see Grandma again. I'm not making fun of not seeing Grandma again. No. The Holy Spirit moves Paul's pen to say, I am a debtor to the Greeks and the barbarians, the wise and the unwise, so much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel. There is a great need for me to preach the gospel. I'm not ashamed to preach the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew and to the Greek. For in that gospel is revealed the righteousness of God, the righteousness from God, whereby a sinful, unholy, unrighteous man, woman, or young person can be lifted out of sin's captivity, lifted out of Satan's captivity, lifted from being an enemy of God to a son or daughter of God by the precious blood of Jesus. Amen. The good news is needed because of the wrath of God. This is not an isolated teaching. Jesus himself said in John 3:36, he that believeth on the Son has everlasting life. He that believes not the Son of God shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. The wrath of God is abiding on all who are outside of Christ. Paul would tell the Corinthians, therefore, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. He says, I'm a debtor, I'm ready, I'm not ashamed. And sadly, multitudes in the churches today, from the pulpit to the back pew, are so engaged with the affairs of this life that at best we'll attend church on Sunday morning if nothing else is in the way. We've got sports, we've got hobbies, we've got all manner of entertainment, we've got all manner of things that we're doing, and we're debtors to those. Oh, I'm sorry, I won't be there today. Or I'm sorry. I mean, usually it's not even a sorry. I'm a debtor, I'm ready, and I'm getting ready, or I'm not ashamed, and out we go. Hither and thither. Am I a stranger to Paul's urgency for the gospel? When is the last time I walked through a week, and at least sometime during that week, the thought came to my mind, I am a debtor. I'm ready. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ because I've got good news, and the whole world needs it. And the whole world outside of Christ is under the wrath of God, and I have the gospel. God has been gracious enough to save me, and I want others to be delivered from the wrath of God. It's needed. The gospel is needed because of the wrath of God. The Holy Spirit has Paul to shift from the good news of the gospel to the sober news, not the bad news, the sober news of the wrath of God. I don't want to call it bad news because there's nothing wrong with the wrath of God. It is right and righteous that God has wrath against all that is wrong. But it's sober news. Because all unsaved men, women, and youth are under the wrath of God and in danger of perishing. When Jesus came into the world, all men, women, and youth were already under the just and holy wrath of God. Am I gripped by this? As a believer, am I gripped by this? Am I walking among the trees and see men as trees among the masses of people and see trees as men walking, and I don't see a soul one heartbeat away from an eternity without Christ because they abide under the wrath of God, as Jesus said. If I'm not gripped by this, I'll likely think that, well, if man needs salvation, God should give it to him. God owes it to him. Man is basically good. And if God is love, he should save everybody. No one will treasure the gospel unless they are awakened to the just and holy wrath of God. Has there ever been a time in my life when I've been awakened to my sin and the holy wrath of God and fled to Jesus for rescue? The wrath of God is all throughout the Bible. I'll never forget being in a hospital room here in Gallatin talking to this fellow, and I must have said something about the wrath of God. I'd have no remembrance, but he just almost stood up in his bed and said, "My God is not a God of wrath. My God is a God of love." His God is an idol, a figment of his own creation. And that is the major God of America, the God of love. God is love, hallelujah. But he is holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And God is not ashamed of his wrath. Amen. God's wrath was poured out in the Garden of Eden. God's wrath was poured out at the flood. God's wrath was poured out at Sodom and Gomorrah. But most of all, God's wrath was poured out upon his Son at Calvary. And in the time when people are wringing their hands and writing all kinds of things and have all kinds of opinions as to what is going on in the world, and especially what is going on in America, well, it's very simple. The wrath of God. And so a pastor wrote me back and said, "Do you mean to tell me that God's wrath was at play where not only are the wicked killed by a wicked person with a gun, but the righteous are killed?" Well, there's a distinction between the direct judicial wrath of God and the wrath of God that is spoken about here in verse 24, 26, and 28. And I'm going to pull from a couple of different translations as I read those verses for us. "Wherefore, God also gave them up." Now, the word wrath is not used here. But God is demonstrating his settled and consistent opposition to sin. And he is decreeing an action. And frankly, in this present hour, there possibly is not a worse form or a more deadly or a more serious form, maybe the better way to put it, of the wrath of God than what is being spoken of here in Romans, where God gave them up to uncleanness. God abandoned them to impurity. God let them go ahead into every sort of sex sin to do whatever they wanted. Verse 26, and God gave them up. God handed them over to disgraceful passions. God abandoned them to the passions and brought dishonor to themselves. Even the women turned against God's natural plan for them and indulged in sex sin with each other. And the men also the same way, neglecting sexual intercourse with women, burned in their lust toward other men. Working that which is unseemly, receiving in themselves a recompense of their error. One of the things I see beyond that, but underneath that, is that people are so confused today, they don't know if they're a man or a woman. You and I might think that that's foolish. We don't understand it. It is not natural. It is a consequence of the wrath of God, of God saying, okay, go. Go do what you want to. Let's see where it leads. God abandoned them to unworthy impulses. God allowed them to become the slaves of their degenerate minds. Being filled with all unrighteousness and fornication and wickedness and maliciousness, full of envy, murder, and on it goes. The wrath of God is not only a historical fact. The wrath of God is a present tense reality. And the wrath of God is coming. The whole book of Revelation, one of the major themes of the book of Revelation, is that God is going to settle up all accounts. The wrath of God is coming, and a rebellious mankind are going to be hiding under the rocks to hide from the wrath of the Lamb. Revelation 6:15 through 17. Jesus says in Matthew 10:28, do not fear those who can kill the body, and that's all they can do. Fear him who can destroy body and soul in hell. The wrath of God makes the gospel necessary, which makes the testimonies of many people downright scary. You can go to testimony meetings all around the country and you can hear people say things like this: well, now that I'm a Christian, I'm much happier. I have much more peace. I'm able to take pressures better. I'm easier to live with, and I've got a wonderful future. And let's say that I'm an unbeliever and I'm listening to you tell that, and I say, well, you know, that's wonderful, and life is better for you now and pleasant, and you're going to have eternal happiness. But so the next night I go and sit down with a bunch of Mormons and they give the same testimony. Oh, yes, they will. Very similar. And the next night I go to some other cult. And then some other cult. Same basic testimony. Or I'll go to an AA meeting. Same basic testimony. It's all about how things are better for me. Now, I thank God that there are temporal blessings that come with salvation. But when Paul testifies why he's not ashamed of the gospel, that's not what he says. He says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ because it is God's gospel. It is God's power. It is a revelation of righteousness from God that is given to unrighteous sinners who repent and believe. Folks everywhere are going about trying to seek their own righteousness. And Paul is not ashamed because knowing that all men are under the wrath of God, only Jesus can set us free from the holy wrath of God. His gospel is the gospel of the righteousness of and from God. Only the blood of Jesus can satisfy the holy wrath of God. Amen. And you might not use these terms, but you would agree with them. As a child of God, I became overwhelmed with the burden of my sin. I came to realize I was under the wrath of God. I came to realize I deserved hell, and I fled to Christ. Or in the simple terms of the publican, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Look at verse 18 and 21. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold down or who suppress the truth. God's wrath is pointed against all ungodliness, the sin of not reverencing God as God. Because when they knew God, verse 21, they glorified Him not as God. That's ungodliness. Neither were thankful, became vain in their imaginations as a part of the judgment. But so God's wrath is against ungodliness. Verse 18 again, God's wrath is against all unrighteousness, the sin of disregarding God's holy law. And so not only were they, when they had been given revelation of God in verse 21, they glorified Him not, neither were thankful. They became vain in their imaginations, a foolish heart was dark, and they proceeded down a path of sin. Now let me just pause to ask, why do saved people need to listen to this? You say, you know, I'm saved, I don't need this. Well, do you think we can afford to live our Christian life without understanding that God hates sin? Do you not realize that one of the problems that we dilly-dally around with sin and make excuses with sin and so easily fall into sin is we've forgotten that God hates sin and that the wrath of God is poured out against sin? Have we forgotten the many testimonies in the Old Testament where God said to His people Israel, the same basic thing, I'll give you what you want, but you've got leanness to your soul. God wants to develop in us a hatred of sin. God wants to develop in our souls a holy fear of God. God wants us to be impressed and moved with praise to God for the truth of His mercy and His grace that comes to us through Jesus Christ. If I'm not impressed with the problem, I won't be very impressed with the solution. That's why you have Ephesians 2, 1, 2, and 3. You were in deep weeds. You were dead, living according to the course of the world, under the power of the prince of the air, and children of wrath, even as others. Never forget that. How'd you get out of it? But God. And God wants us to be moved to warn sinners to flee from the wrath of God. The evidence that you and I don't think much about the wrath of God is that we aren't warning sinners. Noah warned sinners. Paul warned sinners. Jesus said, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. If you're here and you're outside of Christ, you're under the wrath of God, and God is under no obligation to keep you out of hell one moment longer. John 3:36, you're under the wrath of God. You're abiding under the wrath of God. But you might be sitting here, you've had good health and safety, and you eat right, and you exercise. God could withdraw His mercy from you, and you're one heartbeat away from an eternity without God. And you would be in eternity crying with the rich man. Just a cup of water, just a tip of water on your finger. Abraham, no. Send someone for my brothers, no. If they won't believe the word of God, they would not believe though one came back from the dead. Notice in verse 21, they refuse to acknowledge and act on the truth about God, which they knew. They refuse to surrender to the lordship, the sovereignty of God as boss. They refuse to express gratitude to God. And what happens? What is the judgment that comes to such ones? They become vain in their imagination. Their foolish heart is darkened, professing themselves to be wise. They become fools. The heart is darkened. The mind won't reason right. The emotions won't function right. The will is no longer has any heart to be in harmony with God. Are we describing most Americans in and out of the church today? Oh, we don't have a sin problem. We just have mental illness. And mental hospitals that used to be open or closed. And I was reading a long article about that. And I was raised close to Milledgeville, Georgia. If you were raised in middle Georgia in the 50s and 60s, and someone said, you ought to go to Milledgeville, they were saying that you're not stable enough to be here outside of Milledgeville. There was a huge complex, a huge mental institution where you were locked up. And you were experimented on, given every kind of medication and shock treatment and everything else under the sun, and you were never let out. And I don't know all the dynamics and the politics, but they've closed down a lot of that. I know a fellow I used to work with. His only problem, so far as I know, was that he was deaf. And he had an anger problem, which I'm sure was rooted in not being saved. Somehow or another, they locked him up. He's now 75 years old, and he's been there ever since. What a wonderful solution. Get these people out of our way, and we don't have to deal with them. Sin does affect us mentally, but there's no out from it except by the blood of Jesus. Another consequence of refusing to acknowledge the truth and refusing to surrender to God and refusing gratitude, not only the darkened mind, the foolish emotions, but also idol worship. In verse 21 and 22 and 23. And so God gave them over. It's a crowded road of people suppressing the truth, refusing God as boss, refusing thankfulness to God, becoming more and more blind, confused, unstable, and becoming fools who idolize man, and becoming violently enslaved to every unspeakable sin that is listed in verse 26 through 32. Go home and meditate on those verses again. And also, don't forget, in meditating upon those verses, when you read that horrible list of sins, he says at the end in verse 32, who knowing the judgment of God, and that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Most of the entertainment on television and video games and DVDs and all the rest is a taking of the things that are listed in verse 26 through 31 and making movies about them and having shows about them and having games about them and glorying in them and even little kids getting their entertainment from them. And we wonder, what's wrong with America? And we wonder, why is the Spirit of God so grieved in the churches? You can't take in all that garbage without being affected. We can be like Achan, and instead of hiding gold under a tent, we're hiding a lifestyle under a tent, and we go in and we walk among the people of God, and we preach and we teach and we do whatever, and the Spirit of God is grieved. And so, we'll have to pump up the energy. We'll have to get somebody to pump us up and have some entertainment. Oh, my friends, I don't know of anybody who needs to hear the message of the wrath of God more than God's people. More than the preacher in the pulpit. This morning, will we receive and act upon God's truth? Freshly surrender to God as boss. Express gratitude for God. Be amazed at a righteousness that is from God that is given to unworthy sinners. And are there those here who need to flee the wrath of Holy God and flee to Christ and cry out, "Oh God, be merciful to me, a sinner"? Oh, Father, you don't beat around the bush with your word. And we thank you for giving us the truth of your word. And we ask, Father, for grace to be those who at the foot of the cross this morning, amazed at your grace, amazed at your mercies, grieved, deeply grieved. In how we have quenched the Holy Spirit and grieved the Holy Spirit. How that we have passion about a lot of things. We give time and energy to a lot of things, but we lack Paul's passion of feeling an indebtedness and an excitement about giving the gospel to a lost and dying world. Father, may this be a day of brokenness. May this be a day of humility. May this be a day when we go home and we set aside time to open our Bibles to this passage and say, "Oh Lord God, by your grace, I'm your child. But I've let the spirit of the age dictate my lifestyle, my priorities. I don't have time for your word. I don't have time for prayer. I don't have time or even much desire or any desire to give the gospel to anyone. I don't even see people as lost people. There could be some here today, and we're no different than that world out there, and somebody sins and we say, "Well, how horrible, how could they do that?" As a Christian, we know how they do it. They're slaves. And but for the grace of God, we'd be doing what they're doing. Oh, Father, may this be a day of rejoicing in the good news of the gospel. Because we have met face to face the sober, serious news of the wrath of God. And for this we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing and obey the Lord as we sing.